Great. Hello, everybody. Thank you so much for coming to my talk, especially right before lunchtime. I know it's kind of a tricky one. So I'm here to talk about sketching and how to win at Pictionary. Please note the little asterisk next to how to win at Pictionary. It's not guaranteed, but I will have some tips for you, both for sketching and for how to win at Pictionary, which should be helpful. Please also note that it was stated earlier, this is how to win a Pictionary. If you stayed here hoping to win a board game, unfortunately I'm not actually handing out a game of Pictionary today, so sorry about that. So let's get in. Firstly, just a quick thanks to the sponsors. It's been a really amazing day so far, seeing all these talks, and this is my first DDD ever, and the first conference that I've gotten to speak at, so I'm really excited to have this opportunity. The volunteers have done such an amazing job. It's been really great so far. So to start out with, raise your hand if you can draw. Couple of you? All right, that's really awesome. It's kind of a scary thing to admit that you can draw. I think a lot of people are quite intimidated about drawing in front of other people or showing other people things that they've drawn. It's not something that a lot of us do after primary school, I suppose, unless you happen to be a professional artist. And it kind of leaves us in this position where to draw, it feels like you either have to be a child or a professional artist. And there's not a huge amount in between, which is a real pity because I found that sketching is a really useful tool for generating and understanding ideas, making sense of the world, and also communicating ideas, which is probably why kids are told to draw in the first place. It's just a useful tool for that. So that's why I wanted to share a few things with you today that I found useful in my work communicating using sketching. Now, I loved drawing as a kid. This is me really happily drawing in some of my primary school drawings. I told my parents at quite a young age that when I grew up, I wanted to draw pictures as a living. I wanted to be an artist. They weren't particularly keen on that idea. I think they had this image in their head that I was just going to become a starving artist. So they told me instead that I should think about studying engineering. I could become an engineer. Being a kid, I decided I'll go along with that. I don't mind maths and science and code, so I started going into that. But I never stopped drawing. I kept doing it as a hobby. I would be drawing in my lecture notes, so I'd be drawing during classes. I'd draw in textbooks. I went through a phase where I was super into anime and drawing things. These are all quite old. So I just kept doing it. These days, that's kind of morphed more into lettering and calligraphy style things with quite simplistic drawings. I suppose lettering is kind of like drawing letters, if you think about it. And that's what led me not to a career in engineering at the end of the day, possibly because I was drawing during all of my lectures. But instead, that led me to a career in design, which was then ended up in design and technology. It kind of all worked in together. And now I'm a user experience designer at Bankwest. And I'm still drawing as my hobby. It's still something that I really love, even though my day-to-day work isn't necessarily always extremely visual. I've started trying to bring sketching not just as part of my hobbies, but as something that I use in my day-to-day work. And it's something which I found to be really effective, even though, as I said, it can be really scary showing other people your sketches or standing up and sketching in front of other people. But that's why I want to try and use those experiences to encourage you to have a go at doing that yourself. Now, when I talk about sketching, you might be thinking of something like this. This is a quick sketch that I did of my doggy Jasper, a little fluffy dog, and there's a bow tie sometimes. When I was doing this sketch, I wanted to draw a portrait of my dog. So that was the only reason that I wanted. I wanted something pretty to hang on my wall. It is a sketch, but as you can see, it's aiming for realism here because I wanted to capture the personality of my dog. This is not what we're talking about today. What I'm talking about is getting across basic ideas. They can be simple or they can be complicated, but they don't need to get to this level of detail or realism. If you wanted to get across the idea of a dog, you can really simplify it to something more like this, which is maybe a little bit more doable. If you happen to be an artist or drawing is one of your hobbies, then, you know, you might be at the level or better than me at sketching to do that kind of thing. But for this kind of sketching, you might have to pull back a little bit and not go to that amount of detail for reasons that I'll get to in just a sec. The way I like to think of it is like a game of Pictionary. So if you haven't played Pictionary before, it's a game of skill. It's a game of drawing skill, but it's drawing with a twist. It's not about how good you can draw. It's about how effectively you can use drawing to communicate really, really quickly. So the way that it's played, it's normally in small teams of two or three people. One person will pick up a card and they'll be given a word or a phrase that they have to then draw. And the rest of their teammates have to guess it without the person who's drawing speaking or writing down any words or numbers. Some people tend to think that an artist or a visual artist is necessarily going to be have an unfair advantage at Pictionary because they can draw. So it's a drawing game. Naturally, they should just be able to win at it really easily. But I found this to really not be the case, especially if an artist hasn't really played Pictionary before and doesn't quite understand how it works. If you're an artist or used to drawing as a hobby or for beauty, then it can be really hard to stop the tendency to become a perfectionist, to go back in, to edit things, to be try to do a really clever and illustrative idea. For example, a very artistic friend of mine was telling me that she once picked up a card which said to draw Cupid. And in her mind, she started drawing out this beautiful little cherub with wings and holding a bow and arrow. So that's exactly Cupid, right? But then another team came and they just drew a love heart with an arrow through it, and they won straight away before she'd gotten to drawing it. If you think about, if you've ever played Pictionary before and you think about how it looks at the end, the results tend to not be beautiful and perfectionist and really clever. Sometimes when you're looking at them after the fact, they're not even legible. You might look at a winning entry at Pictionary and go, how the hell did they guess what that is? Because it's not about beauty, it's about communicating effectively and really quickly. Which brings me to my first tip for sketching and how to win at Pictionary. This is my number one most important tip. If you only walk away with one piece of advice today, I want it to be this, and that is, don't be an artist. This is not art. So Pictionary is not art. Sketching to communicate ideas also is not art. So if you're not an artist, don't be intimidated by the fact that you're not an artist. If you think, I'm a technical person, I'm not a creative person, therefore I can't draw. Remember, it's kind of like Pictionary. You're trying to get an idea across quickly and effectively. You're not trying to create something which is a really beautiful or clever illustration. And that's completely fine. On the other hand, if you are an artist, you might have to bring down your level a little bit, your level of fidelity, so you can get that kind of speed and effectiveness that those kind of sketches that you might see in Pictionary might bring. So when would you use sketching to communicate ideas? There's a few different scenarios and a few different audiences that I can think of, which brings me to my next tip, which is consider your audience. So in Pictionary, you could get paired up with your best friend or your partner who you've known a really long time. You have that kind of ESP, you can just communicate really easily, just draw a little squiggle and kind of look at them. They know exactly what it is you're on about. And everyone looks at the things later and says that you're cheating, but no, you actually just know each other that well. Or you could get paired up with somebody who you don't know very well, or somebody who's just really, really bad at guessing things at Pictionary. I tend to always get paired up with with one of my cousins at family parties at Pictionary, and he's really, really terrible. So for that kind of, if you're paired up with that kind of person, you might want to try and go a little bit more refined, try and do a bit of a high fidelity, make sure that you go quite a clear sketch, still within the time, so that you can be sure that they're going to guess what it is. It's the same thing with sketching. It's important to think about who it is that you're going to be sketching for, what it is that you're trying to get across, and how it's going to be consumed, how much control you have over that. And that's going to affect the fidelity that you're going to need to do for it to be able to get that idea across. So the first scenario that I tend to use sketching for is sketching for myself. So this tends to be super fast, scribbly. These are some sketches that I did in preparation for this talk today. So I had my dot points out, I knew what kind of key points that I wanted to hit, and I knew that I wanted my talk to be extremely visual and almost entirely hand-drawn. So to do this, I had to plan it out in advance, and the way I do that is through a bunch of thumbnail sketches. So these are just really quite small. As I said, they're quite scribbly. They might not make sense to anybody other than myself, but that's completely fine because they're not intended to show anybody. They're for my own reference, except also I'm showing them today to prove a point. So when you're sketching for yourself, remember that you don't have to make it really beautiful and clever. The idea is getting ideas out of your head and onto paper and working through them really nice and quickly. And if you need to throw it away and start again, scribble something out, that's completely fine. You haven't spent too much time. The point is getting it out of your head so that you can work through whether it's a good idea or not, and you can work through the best way to then refine it later on. I use this kind of sketching quite frequently. I do some user interface designs, so they tend to be really good for rapid prototyping, just getting things out, the beginning parts of customer journeys, mind maps if you're trying to work through complex ideas, visualizing data to figure out the best way that you can take a complex or abstract idea and turn it into something visual and easy to consume. There's a lot of reasons when this can be useful. As I said, they're quite quick to do. You don't have to worry too much about legibility. But just a proviso to that, if you're sketching for yourself, but you know that you're going to be referring to it a year down the track, make sure that future you can understand what current you is going on about and can understand your own handwriting. Because I've gone back to some notes that I've taken a long time ago and just gone, what the hell was I trying to do here? So try and make sure it makes sense to future you. The next audience is sketching together. So this can be kind of like Pictionary. So in Pictionary, you'll be sketching something and your rest of your team will be watching it, looking at reactions as they're guessing things. And that's going to enhance their understanding of it and their ability to guess it, which is probably one of the reasons why their results at the end might not look quite right, because they're gauging your reactions as they're guessing things. So for example, this is one of the user experience designers at Bankwest, Chrissy. So here she's demonstrating how to draw a customer journey map to some case students. And because she's drawing it out and explaining it as she's going, those students are going to have a different understanding of what a customer journey map is and how to create it, and a deeper understanding than if they were just presented with a diagram and told to try and digest it on their own. So I find this kind of sketching, even if it's just one person who is standing up and doing it and talking as they're going along, or brainstorming and working through things together, it creates a shared understanding. You're taken along that journey together, so it can be really useful for that. Another case where I've used it is in ideation sessions. So I've run these with plenty of non-designers. In fact, I think it can be better in that way. So this is my team that we did some brainstorming for ideas around a particular feature. So they were challenged to do a six-up. If you've never done one of those before, or a crazy eight, they're kind of similar. The idea is to sketch six or eight, if you're doing a crazy eight, ideas down on paper in a very limited amount of time. So they had to do six ideas in just 3 minutes. Really, really tough to get fancy and be an artist or even write words when you only have 30 seconds to get down each idea. So similar to sketching for yourself, it can be really fast, definitely is not always beautiful, but because you're working through something together and as a team, you create that shared understanding. So you're figuring out ideas and also communicating them at the same time. So this sort of thing is great for teams. It doesn't even have to be a formal workshop like these were. It can just be ad hoc if you're in a meeting or just talking to somebody at their desk and you're having difficulty getting on the same page. Sometimes words and hand gestures are not enough. It can help to grab a piece of paper and a pen and just to scribble out what it is that you're trying to get across. And that way you create that shared understanding. And the last audience is sketching to show. So for me, these tends to be the result after I've sketched for myself or with other people. And I need to get it kind of presentation ready. So if I'm going to be presenting it to stakeholders, or it's going to be in a document which I know other people are going to be consuming down the track. So like when you are sketching in Pictionary for someone that you don't know very well, in this case you might need a bit of a higher fidelity. So for example, these are little sketches of people that I use quite often. As you can tell, they're still not super detailed because that's not the point of what I'm trying to get across. But I try to make them a little bit cleaner than my scribbly people, which you'll see a little bit later. And I found this quite a useful tool to bring it back to a very customer-focused discussion. Just adding these images in there can make people remember that a customer is at the center of whatever it is that we're talking about. So I use them quite frequently. Another example is these diagrams which I've done. So these are taking maybe a slightly abstract and difficult to understand idea, in this case how people use their savings accounts in different ways, and just creating a visual representation of this. I found it quite difficult to discuss and to compare these different methods of going about this, so I tried to come up with a diagram to make it a little bit easier to read. Now, I could have done this in like Sketch or Visio or something with nice boxes and using like actual fonts, but I found these sort of sketches, even when you are presenting it to other people in a professional context, I do find that they can communicate better and they really stand out compared to just very simple, clean black and white boxes. If you're interested in visualizing data in different ways and through sketches, I really recommend this book called The Back of a Napkin by Dan Rome. It really goes into quite a bit of detail, and it's not, as I said, about being an artist. It's about communicating data and ideas really effectively and really convincingly. So that's both working out the ideas and communicating them. Really excellent book. So why would you use sketching? There's a few different reasons, but the main one is very similar to Pictionary, and that is speed. Which brings me to my next tip, make it snappy. So in Pictionary, you are playing against a timer, or you might be playing against another team who are drawing the exact same thing and might be faster to you. So speed is really, really crucial. It's the whole point of the game. With sketching to communicate ideas, speed can be really handy as you're going through these things. For example, this is an example of sketching for myself. It's just a fictional example. And this literally is a lot of my work. It's sort of mapping out customer journeys in quick little scribbles with my own sort of crappy handwriting and ideas of how customers might react to things. And it's really, really fast. I can do these in a few minutes whilst thinking, whilst I'm putting ideas down. Quite often, I'll scrap it, I'll start again, and that's completely fine. It's rapid prototyping of ideas, but working through it on paper instead of in your head. Pictures are also not just faster to draw, but they're faster to read, which is why things like emoji and reaction GIFs are so popular. You can communicate something without having to use a bunch of words, and the person on the other end, assuming they understand you and the context that you're using it in, will understand what it is that you're trying to say without having to read through it. You can tell at a glance what it is. An example of this is what I've started doing recently. I work with, again, this is a fictional example, I work with a lot of journey maps kind of like this. So they're sort of like flow charts it's pretty easy to read. It is quite clear. It's step by step. But you do kind of have to read each piece as you're going along. What I've started doing is adding some little sketches alongside these flowcharts. What this does is it means at a glance, if you're looking at this, you can understand what it is that the flowchart is trying to say in a very, very quick glance. And then if you need a bit more information, you can go down and read what the text is in each stage. So it makes it a lot faster to read, but I also find it makes it a little bit more engaging. And I find that adding in pictures of people, again, as I was saying, it centres it on the human aspect of what it is that you're trying to communicate instead of just the word customer, where it's very easy to think, oh, it's just another person. But it's almost different to see an individual on there, and it reframes it. You might be thinking, why not use stock photography instead of sketches? Personally, I found finding good stock photography, which isn't cheesy, like this one here, which is appropriate for what it is that you're trying to do and actually makes sense, and that has enough variations and versatility to use in different ways, actually takes longer than just doing the sketch in the first place. So personally, I still prefer this. I also think that sketches can be faster to read visually in the sense that they don't have as much visual detail, which is distracting and unnecessary. So they can be still faster to read than a photo. One more example is it can be used to... I use sketching quite frequently in doing sketch notes. So this is one that I did this morning at the keynote from Carolina, which was amazing. And I have started doing these during talks, during meetups, during conferences. I know some people do them when reading books or listening to podcasts. And aside from looking kind of cool, I feel that they really help my understanding and my memory of the talk. There actually is some science around the fact that if you are doodling or drawing or even handwriting notes, that synthesis between your mind and your hand and your ears, I suppose, bringing in all those senses, actually increases your understanding and your memory of what's being talked about. And I found that talks that I sketchnote, I remember much, much better than ones where I just sit there and try to listen really intently. I also find that when I go back to it later, these little images and little dot points, which I found the most important, are enough to trigger my memory to think about the rest of the talk. So it's great for me to then also be able to remember it later. I get asked a lot of questions about sketch notes, so if you are keen to have a go at it, I recommend this particular talk, and the slides will be sent out later, I assume, from a designer called Ava Lockel-Lamb. She also has a book about sketchnoting, but in this talk, she live sketchnotes about how to do sketchnotes. It's really, really impressive, and it goes right to the basics, and she encourages people to follow along and do it as she's going through it. It's definitely worth looking at. Next, what do you use to start sketching? This tends to be the area that people seem to focus on a lot with me. I get a lot of questions about these. And personally, I love stationery. As I mentioned earlier, I do calligraphy and lettering. I have a huge collection of pens and different papers and paintbrushes and inks. And I can be really fussy about what I use because in calligraphy, for example, the tools that you use is actually really quite important. Sketching, however, is completely different. I don't care what I use for it, which brings me to my next tip. Use what you've got. Don't wait until you have the perfect pen and really beautiful field notes notebook to start sketching, because you don't need that. In Pictionary, you might, when you first buy the game, you get these little notepads and some little pencils, but if you've had the game for quite a long time, you end up losing them or using them up. So most people end up just grabbing whatever pieces of paper and pens they can find around. And that's totally fine. It's fine to play the game with just whatever random resources you have. It's the same with sketching. Any pen is better than no pen. So this is what I tend to use for sketching most of the time, just whatever pen or drawing type thing happens to be around, and random pieces of paper. Usually this is paper where it's been printed on one side, but I want to draw on the other side because I feel really bad for the trees, not using both sides of the paper. And that's really all you need, just whatever tools you have around. If you're waiting to have the perfect tools, that moment to sketch and that idea might have escaped. So I think it's worth capturing it with whatever you happen to have on hand, regardless of how fancy it is. I do, of course, use a bunch of other different things. I have stopped taking my fancy pens into work because people borrow them, and especially the brush pens. They're like, oh, this pen is weird, and mash it into the table and destroy it. So I've gone to using just regular pens that the work provides me now. If I can give a couple of tips with these ones here, if you happen to be an artist or you feel yourself in danger of becoming an artist, try to avoid the pencil because it can be really tempting to start shading and erasing things and getting all really pretty. Again, not the point of sketching. If you find yourself falling into getting too much into the detail, getting a bit too fancy with things, I recommend using something like a Sharpie or any sort of thick marker, because it's really hard to get detailed when you have really fat lines. So that's my recommendation. I do have to point out the iPad and the pencil. I use these quite a lot. It tends to be more when I'm sketching to show, but as I said earlier, I normally will start with a random pen and paper as I'm working through ideas, because similar to the pencil, or actually even worse, the undo button is really, really tempting, and it's so easy to erase and to move things around and to get really finessed with it. And when you're working through the idea and you need that rapid prototyping phase, that is not what you need. That said, you don't need fancy tools like this to get started in sketching. And I hate to break it to you, but if you haven't done any sketching or you feel that you're not very good with a pen and paper, your skills will not magically improve by going into a digital format. So it's good to start with what you have, and then once you start reaching the limits of that and feeling pain points, if you feel that you need to start showing your sketches to stakeholders and want them to look a bit more professional, then consider investing money in fancy tools. But otherwise, it's kind of an expensive toy if you don't end up using it. And lastly, how do you get started in sketching? I don't have enough time to run a complete workshop on sketching in the last few minutes of my talk here today, but I do have a few useful tips for you. First one would be think, then sketch. So in Pictionary, when you pick up a card, the official rules, I think, say that you have 5 seconds to think about what it is you're going to sketch before you start doing it. I think when most people play, you end up having a bit longer. Like, oh, what am I going to do? And you need to use that time to, as I was saying earlier, consider your audience and what they're going to recognize. Similar with sketching to communicate ideas or for work, it's not enough just to see something and then sketch that exactly like you might if you were doing a realistic kind of artwork. You really need to think about, firstly, the idea, and then also how you can communicate the most effectively and also efficiently and unambiguously to your audience. So the thinking part is really crucial. I would say it's even more important than just being able to have artistic ability to sketch. The idea, the ability to take abstract concepts and to turn them into a visual is really important. It can help to offset some of that thinking by having a bunch of things that you know how to draw before you start sketching to communicate ideas, because that way you're not thinking about how to draw the thing, you're thinking about what the thing is instead of doing both at the same time. I recommend this book called Presto Sketching by a Sydney designer called Ben Crothers. It's super, super detailed. It goes right to the basics of drawing and how to use that to communicate and also to facilitate workshops. It goes into a lot of detail. And Ben and quite a few others have talked about this idea of having a bunch of things that you might use quite frequently that you know how to draw, that you can pull out whenever you need it. I like to think of it as similar to learning a new language, or even learning a new programming language. I think quite a few of you will be developers here today. At first, when you start learning it, you might have to go back to references quite frequently. The number of words or phrases that you happen to know off the top of your head might start off quite small, and it might take quite a bit of effort to pull out the right ones as you need them. But as your experience and your vocabulary grows, you'll be able to communicate a lot more eloquently and effectively to use those. And similar, again, to language, the number of things which you can recognise might be a little bit different to the number of things that you actually know how to sketch, even if they are simple everyday objects. So it can help to have a bunch of things that you know that you might use quite frequently in sketches that you can pull out when you need them. These tend to fall into a couple of different categories. There are pictographs, which look like the thing that they represent, and there are ideographs, which are more metaphorical, so like a light bulb to represent an idea. But you might not know how to draw these things off the top of your head. You do have to learn them somewhere, as I said, even if they are everyday objects. So don't be afraid to look at references and examples. Google Images, websites like the Noun Project, and just icons can be really handy just to figure out how to find the right stylization of things that you're trying to communicate. For example, I saw somebody sketch this once, and I wasn't really sure what it was trying to say. And that person said, it's an envelope. And sure, it's quite quick to draw, and maybe there are envelopes that look like that, but if you do a couple of tweaks, this is now unambiguously an envelope. Now, you might be able to recognise that quite easily and think, oh, well, that's pretty obvious. But if you haven't really looked at like an envelope or a simplification of an envelope, you might not know how to draw those lines and that they are just slightly offset, because that's how the flap of an envelope works. You need to look at references to do that, and that's completely fine. You can utilise references. Here's an example of part of my visual vocabulary. Because I tend to use these quite frequently, I have done them digitally so that I can adapt them quite easily. That's why I've got a little template type person that I can add features to. Because I work in user experience design, working on mobile app features mainly, I have a lot of people and phones, and people holding phones, and people holding phones and having feelings, because they tend to be what I use. Your visual vocabulary might be a little bit different depending on what it is that you do, but it's helpful to just be able to know how to draw these things really quickly. I've drawn so many pictures of a hand holding a phone that I can do that super easily now, even though I generally suck at drawing hands. It can be important to find the right level of stylization as well. I've landed on the style of people because it's very simple and easy for me to draw, and it's a nice big face to add expressions, because like I said, people with feelings is kind of what I do. You might choose to take inspiration from simple comics. So personally, I wouldn't go any more complicated than Peanuts level, because otherwise you might be spending a bit too much time doing little character design, which isn't quite necessary. If your level is more stick people, like XKCD, that's totally fine. That might be all that you need. If you need to show people with feelings and you might want to put a face on there, that's completely fine. Find the right level of stylization for you, for your purpose and your audience. And lastly, I really love this idea of pencil mileage, which was shown to me by an artist called Alice Lee. It's the idea that as you're putting marks down on paper, if you consider them in one big long line, it will eventually stretch for miles. And as you build up that mileage, your confidence and your experience will grow. And I like this idea because it's all about being prolific. Just get in there and start doing it. Try to avoid the temptation to just be intimidated by it and not do it at all. You really just have to keep pumping out the sketches to get good at sketching. So a quick recap for my tips. Number one, don't be an artist. This is not art. Number two, consider your audience and then adjust your level of fidelity accordingly. Number three, make it snappy. Number four, use what you've got. Don't wait until you have the fancy tools to start sketching. And number five, think, then sketch. And I'd like to leave you with a last little challenge. Have a think about what would be in your visual vocabulary. What kind of things would you need to sketch day to day to communicate the ideas that you need to? What kind of pictographs and ideographs might be in that? Or maybe it's just boxes and arrows, and that actually still counts as sketching as well. And that's all from me. So thank you very much for coming.